Do you feel that you're running on empty with all the constant wear down from the COVID virus and all the fallout from the political campaigning? Do you feel you're running on empty? Well, this morning we'll learn that even though we may feel very empty, God has so much fullness to give to us. This is also our Stewardship Sunday, when we are thankful to God for all the many blessings that He gives to us.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Our Old Testament lesson is from the prophet Amos, the 5th chapter.
Woe to you who desire the day of the Lord. Why would you have the day of the Lord? It is darkness and not light, as if a man fled from a lion and a bear met him, or went into the house and leaned his hand against the wall and a serpent bit him. Is not the day of the Lord darkness and not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? I despise your feasts, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And the peace offerings of your fatted animals, I will not look upon them. Take away from me the noise of your songs. To the melody of your harps, I will not listen. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteous like an ever-flowing stream. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We face pressures that cause us to make choices apart from God, and those pressures can lead us away from God. We compromise the truth of God for that which seems to work for us. We need to examine our lives and see how our priorities get mixed up. Lord God, we get involved in so many things that we forget about you and what is really important in our lives. We measure in the minors of how many things we can have in life, how we can make ourselves look better than others, and in how we live for our own pleasures. Our priorities are so messed up that we are helpless. So we go to you, seeking your mercy. God, in his love, made you and me his priority. He sent his son, Jesus Christ, to take away the sin that mixes up our priorities. In the name of Jesus and by his command, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 25th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom.
5 of them were foolish,
and 5 were wise.
For when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them.
But the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps.
As the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight, there was a cry.
Here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him.
Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise,
Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.
But the wise answered, saying,
Since there will not be enough for us and for you, go rather to the dealers and buy for yourselves.
And while they were going to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him to the marriage feast.
And the door shut.
Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying,
Lord, Lord, open to us.
But he answered,
Truly, I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour.
This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Oh, Lord, message this morning comes from the gospel lesson just read. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. We're running on empty. The pandemic has gone on for months now, and we're tired of everything connected with it. People who were careful early on are relaxing their guard, not being as vigilant about social distancing, mask wearing, or hand washing. Doctors and nurses who have been on the front lines for months are watching things get worse and feel helpless as nothing seems to be getting better. Parents and kids who could handle a few weeks of online school are now struggling with handling months of it. Teachers and professors trying to teach in person, online, asynchronous, and flex classes are constantly going with no end in sight. Pandemic fatigue is setting in as case counts, hospitalizations, and deaths continue to rise. We need to remain watchful, but we're tired. We're also suffering from election fatigue. While we may still be waiting for all of the final election results, we at least can rejoice that we're finished with the flood of TV commercials and mailers. But the constant barrage of news stories about politicians and policies, fears and failures are exhausting. And with the close margins in several battleground states and court battles soon to come, as well as the normal careful process used to certify election results, it seems like we'll be waiting a while longer. Well, we're running on empty, especially because it's hard to wait, especially when you don't know how long you'll keep on waiting. That's been a problem for Christians for almost 2,000 years, too. Today's parable and the two we'll hear about the next couple Sundays as we continue going through Matthew 25 all focus on waiting for Jesus to return. They all focus on how we have to stay awake, be alert, be prepared for when Jesus comes again, no matter how long it takes. In today's parable, we're reminded of how hard that is. 10 bridesmaids are waiting for the bridegroom to return. They all have lamps, they all have oil, and they're all supposed to be ready for when the bridegroom comes. It's a time of joyful expectation. Yet the bridegroom is late in coming, and so all the bridesmaids fall asleep. They fail to keep watch. They fail to stay awake. They all let their lamps go out. But half of them, 5 of them, have extra oil. They were prepared to wait. They were prepared for the bridegroom to suddenly appear. They were prepared even if they fell asleep. But the 5 other ones, the 5 foolish ones, are the ones who have to try and run at the last minute, trying to find fuel, find oil, and then find themselves missing the party. Now, as Jesus is telling this parable, he's talking to his disciples alone as the time draws near for him to head to the cross. Knowing that he's going to leave them soon, he's giving them final encouragement, final advice. He tells them to keep watch and to stay ready. But how do we explain the actions of those 5 who are unwilling to share their oil? Especially as we celebrate and remember Stewardship Sunday today, when we're reminded of all we've been given by God and how we're called to use all we have for God's purposes, not our own. Well, one way to think about it is to think of it like an oxygen mask. One of the safety briefings given when you fly on an airplane is a reminder that if the cabin loses pressure and the oxygen masks drop, you're supposed to secure your own mask first before helping someone else put their mask on. Now, that may seem selfish, but it's because you're no good to anyone if you can't breathe. If you start helping someone else and are unable to continue to finish it, then you're both in trouble. But if you take care of yourself first, then you're able to help others. The wise ones act the same way. In the context of the parable, if they shared their oil, no one would have enough for their lamps. Then there'd be no light at all, which would be worse than only half of the light there is supposed to be. But as we wait for Jesus to return, we're reminded of the importance that we need to be ready. We ourselves need to be ready. No one else can be ready for us. And while there's debate over exactly what the oil in the parable represents, whether it's the Holy Spirit or the Word of God or faith or something else entirely, we know that it's something that cannot be shared, cannot be passed on, cannot be taken from someone else. But while we wait for Jesus to return as disciples of Jesus, we also know that we're waiting in hope, we're waiting with hope. We're waiting full of joy. We wait in hope as members of the waiting and hoping church. But we know the church cannot hope and be ready for us any more than the church can believe or love for us. But as we wait to be filled, as we wait for Jesus to return, we also trust in the God who fills the empty. When the Israelites were at their emptiest, hungry, wandering in the desert, God filled them with manna, bread from heaven, and gave them all that they needed. When Elijah was at his emptiest, having fled into the wilderness, asking God to let him die, an angel came and fed him, let him take a nap, and then he continued on to where God would show him he was not alone. When Mary sang of what God had done, she sang that God had filled the hungry with good things, while the rich he'd sent away empty. And when the crowds came to Jesus empty, he filled their bellies, using only 5 loaves and 2 fish, but fed their spirits as well. When God fills the empty, he often does so using others. That's where stewardship comes in. We may not be able to share oil when Jesus returns, but we can share all that we have been given until then. We can share the hope that we have that Jesus will return. We can share what has been entrusted to us to fill the empty around us. We can let God's love and blessings fill us to overflowing, and then we can let the Spirit do the rest. Earlier this week, one of my daughter's online classes talked about being a bucket filler instead of a bucket dipper. The idea is that each of us has a bucket, and others can either fill it or dip from it. And we fill the buckets of those around us when we're kind, thoughtful, responsible, when we share, when we listen, when we help others. But we're a dipper. We just take from others when we're not kind to others, when we don't share, when we don't follow the rules, when we cut in line or use mean words. But because of what Jesus has done on the cross for us, we are forgiven when we are bucket dippers, when we let God fill us, when we come to the places God promises to be. Martin Luther once said, "I have so much to do today that I'll have to spend the first 3 hours in prayer." He needed to spend time with God to be filled up before he could go and do what he needed to do. We too know that we need to let God fill us up. We need to let God fill us up as we hear and read and study God's word. We need to let God fill us as he filled Elijah when we come to communion, filled with Christ's body and blood for strength for the journey as we wait. We are filled with God's blessings so that they can overflow through us into others. We may not know yet when Jesus will return. We don't know when Jesus will return. We don't know when we will go to see Jesus either. We don't know if it will be when Jesus returns or if it's when we're called home. We don't know when we will join those who've gone before us in the faith, those we remembered as we celebrated All Saints Day last week. We just know that those who have gone before us in the faith have kept their lamps trimmed and burning and helped us to do the same. But because Jesus emptied himself on the cross, we are filled as we wait for his return. We are given the strength to endure through our own times of doubt and despair, of trial and temptation, of emptiness and out of fuel feelings. We are given the oil we need to keep our lamps burning. We can endure the hardships that come our way. We can wait for God with brightly shining lamps of faith to light the way in this dark world. And may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. I'm Rich Weiss. Rhonda and I, my wife, have been members here for 45 years. And I have to be honest with you, I miss visiting with my friends at Memorial. Like all of you, I want this virus to go away. The pandemic has made me realize how many things I always took for granted up until last March, when our world changed abruptly. So much of our confidence was shattered as we heard horrific stories about sickness and death coming from major population centers around the world and then here in the United States. I became much more careful about hand washing and scrambled to find and wear a mask. I regretted that I didn't have virus vision that would allow me to avoid contaminated surfaces or people. I stressed myself out with worry. The virus was killing people. Many of my customers at work were struggling and didn't want to buy product, while my sales manager was prodding me to sell more. The shelves in stores were bare. Our board of directors meetings had switched from casual, friendly monthly gatherings to weekly, intense Zoom sessions, where we brainstormed about keeping Memorial running, finding a safe way to worship, and meeting member and staff needs. I guess I was trying to solve all these problems myself. I was working for God's church and thinking I knew better than God what needed to be done. If it wasn't so pathetic, it would be hilarious. Just like watching the Three Stooges, but I was Moe, Curly, and Shemp all rolled into one comical imitation. I guess I've been guilty of this on a regular basis all my adult life, and I don't know why. Maybe I'm a control freak or suffering Lutheran guilt. Yet in Pastor Mark's Reformation Sunday Bible class, he reminded us of St. Paul's letter to the Ephesians, when he spelled out our salvation through faith alone. Our salvation totally depends on God's grace and not on anything you or I might do. Paul told the Romans, "We know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose, even during a pandemic." We have the luxury of knowing 100% that the day we die, we will be in the very presence of God. Not because of all the good things we did, but because we can trust in Jesus Christ alone to save us. There's little doubt Memorial has been blessed with faithful stewards over the years, and especially this year. I never would have guessed in late March that our congregation could be as financially healthy as we are now and holding meaningful worship services 7 months into a pandemic, that caused us to suspend activities as we have always known them, and to have staff adapt to remote worship and classes without ever taking a how-to class. In August, we were even able to dedicate some surplus funds to Mission Central to help support missionaries who, because of COVID-19, haven't been able to raise funds to continue their work. Yes, we've been blessed. Doesn't it give you chills every time you hear the Memorial Choir, brass, or bells perform a musical selection during our taped services? My wife commented recently how much she admires the courage of choir members who each record their own part as a solo so it can be compiled with the other pieces of the puzzle into a beautiful picture. Those friends of ours are using their talents to enrich our worship. I wonder how many experiences we've missed in each other's lives over the last 7 or 8 months during this quarantine. How many missed opportunities to show how much we care? Yet God has cared for us every day since we took our first breath. He cared for us so much that he gave his dear son Jesus to set us free from our sin. Let's all remember to show our own caring for those among us who are struggling. Struggling with sickness, jobs in an economic downturn, or depression and isolation. Pray for each other that God will lift us up and help us to follow his chosen path. Thank you for your continued support of Memorial with your talents, time, and treasure. If we look, we'll find many ways to be stewards during a pandemic and every other day too. Share God's love with everyone you come in contact with through the genuine caring, and pray for those who know you know and those you do not know. Remember, God's grace is free and available to all. We must help share that news. Thank you.
Our epistle lesson is from 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter.
The point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. As it is written, he has distributed freely, he has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. God, you have made clear this point. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Help each one of us to give as he or she has decided in his or her heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Remind us that you are able to make all grace abound to us, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, we may abound in every good work. Your word tells us God has distributed freely, he has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Give us the strength to trust that you who supply seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply our seed for sowing and increase the harvest of our righteousness, that we will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to you. Lord Jesus, you have promised that you will come again. Bless us to be prepared as the five wise virgins were, as we put our trust in you. We pray for the family of Nancy Peterson Sanford, sister-in-law to Mary Peterson, as they grieve her death. Assure them of the hope that we will have, because you will rise all to see you on that last day. Grant healing to those who are ill, Bob Pinnicky and those we name in our hearts at this time. Bless our newly elected officials, and also be with our country as we wait the result of the elections, that it be done peacefully. Guide the work of those who share you with people in other lands, Kibeta and his family in Ethiopia, Nathan and Beth Tonges in China, Carl Hansen in Korea, the Clausings and Grokies on furlough from Africa, the Lutzes in Papua New Guinea, and Amanda Groshek in the Ukraine. Give diligence to students as they approach the end of the semester. Make us thankful for all your blessings to us, even in the little things in life, like a week of warmer weather last week and rain for tomorrow. All this we pray as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, all that we possess is from your loving hand. Give us grace that we may honor you with all we have, always remembering the count we must one day give to Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.